Epiphany. A warm welcome to those who are visiting with us this morning, as well as those of you who are watching this on our YouTube channel. There are lots of announcements in the bulletin and in the insert and in the Friday videos, but let me highlight a few this morning. The flowers on the altar are gifted by Reverend Cardinal in thanksgiving for the members of Church Council. Thank you to those who serve, and thank you for the flowers. As you see in your insert this morning, the soups and sweet sale to combat hunger will return on February 26th. There is a sign-up sheet in the foyer to indicate what you are making, if anything, and also see the list of items needed for the clients of Alternatives for Girls that you receive in the evenings on Friday. Kathy Yasser has a sign-up sheet in the foyer for this as well. In the elevator room, since the elevator work is going to begin this coming week, there are lots of books, videos, and recorded books, and it's all for the taking. So you find them in the elevator room and help yourself. Immediately following the worship service today is our annual meeting. You don't need to worry about grabbing a coffee because it will come here rolled in on a trolley for you. And the annual report was sent out, and printed copies are also available in the foyer if you need one. And finally, our mission moment prayer for this month is about human trafficking. Let us pray. O God, we pray for those who are used for their body and mind in ways that are abusive and neglectful. We pray for fair and honest working conditions which honor human dignity and the values of each person. May our lust for worldly passions and greed be blocked by the Spirit of God that dwells in each one of us. Amen. And so we prepare ourselves for worship and bow our hearts to God as we listen to the Bible. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the eternal voice from heaven, the anointed and beloved one, the Spirit moving over the waters. Amen. As we approach the mystery of God, Let us come in confession, trusting the love of Christ crucified and risen. We pray together. God, who searches us and loves us, you have shown us what is good. We have looked out of our lives to find our way. We have not been just for guilty lives. We have chosen revenge for mercy. We have promoted ourselves as our walking humbly with you. With what shall we come before you? Forgive us our sin and show us your salvation in the face of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Beloved of God, you have not received the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit that is from God, poured out for you in the faithfulness of Jesus Christ. Receive the promise of baptism. You are God's child. Your sins are forgiven. Rejoice and be glad, for yours is the reign of heaven. Amen. kindness always goes before us and follows after us. Summon us into your light and direct our steps in the ways of goodness that come through the cross of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated. And we invite the children to come forward.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I must not have done that bad of a job last week. They let me come back. Okay, so today I want to start with a question. Do you guys find it hard sometimes to decide when to do what's right and to know when what's wrong? Yeah. Who taught you that? How do you know when it's a good decision? When it's good? I'll take that. So today I'm going to talk about another something from my past that helped me out. I thought it might help you guys out too, okay? Can I tell you a little story? Okay, so how many people out there have heard of the phrase WWJD? Do we remember that from way back when? It used to be really, really big. I found a story about that, even more than the story that I heard. So we're gonna put it all together, okay? So WWJD is a popular phrase that Christians often use to try to make good decisions. The acronym stands for, what would Jesus do? Because he's a pretty good person to ask a question to, right? Yeah, I think so too. Okay, so it's actually based on a Bible verse. And this part is the part I did not know. It's based on the Bible verse, John 14:12, which says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth in me, then the works that I do shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father." This phrase, believe it or not, came from the late 19th century. I did not know that. From Francis Wayland Parker, who had said, what would Jesus have done under similar circumstances? So that's where it came back, all the way back from, 1896. So what I remembered this from, if you guys don't remember, it gained popularity again in the 1990s, more precisely 1999, with the Columbine incident. And one of the ladies who lost their life that day, Rachel, she was very, very big with the WWJD and getting that out to everybody. So I thought I would share that with you all too. And part of that were bracelets that you could wear to remind you. So why don't you guys go ahead and pick out a color that you want, any color you want, and I'll help you put that on, okay? Any color you want. And there's plenty if anybody would like one before you go today. And then I'm going to give these to Miss Suzanne for the Spy Kids, so that Spy Kids can have them too. Okay? You want me to help you? All right. It's pretty, yeah. All right, let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for helping us to make the right decisions and living in our hearts.
First reading is from Isaiah 9. There will be no gloom for those who were in anguish. In the former time, the Lord brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he will make glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee, of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with the joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will sing the psalm responsibly led by the women of the choir. Second reading is from 1 Corinthians. Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in agreement, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same purpose. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there are quarrels among you, my brothers and sisters. What I mean is that each of you says, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Has Christ been divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one can say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the household of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, and not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its power. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Now when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea, across the Jordan, Galilee to the other Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, and for those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately, they left their nets and followed him. As Jesus went on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O
Christ. This Sunday, today, we are in the midst of a week that is celebrated by all the Christian denominations during the period of January 18 to 25 in what is known as the Week of Prayer for Christian Unity. Those dates were proposed as far back as 1908 to cover the days between the Feast of St. Peter, which is January 18, and the Feast of St. Paul, this coming Wednesday, the 25th, and therefore had a symbolic significance. The foundation for this week are the words called the Testament of Cardinal Mercier, which reads, quote, "In order to unite with one another, we must love one another. And in order to love one another, we must know one another. And in order to know one another, we must go and meet one another." End quote. Beautiful words, but in so many ways, a week of prayer for Christian unity seems like such an oxymoron when we think of the disunity in the relationship with among Christian communities that we see around us in our community and around the globe. Though sometimes this unity actually sort of works, but only on a local level. In my first parish, in the very small community that I served, all denominations on the spectrum, from the Roman Catholic to the Pentecostal, got along so well in our ministerium, and we did many joint events together. But if we turn to our readings for today, we discover that it doesn't appear to be much unity in the community the Apostle Paul writes about in our second reading in his letter to the Corinthians. We hear Paul appeal to us that we should not have any disagreements or divisions among us. No disagreements or divisions? Makes me want to ask if Paul has ever been to church. Well, of course he hasn't, at least not a church that's set up and operated in the day and age that we live in. But he knew very well that as fallible human beings, we argue and disagree even in the life of the church. And so as we read, Paul begins his letter with an appeal. He said, "I appeal to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ that all of you agree with one another so that there may be no division among you and that you may be perfectly united in mind and thought." As we read on in the second reading, we do understand that it would be utopia if we all agreed on everything. In this reading, it becomes clear why Paul had to deal with the conflict in the church in Corinth. The people were worried about who they were following. Some followed Paul, other Apollos, other Peter, and still others claimed to follow Christ. And with all this splintering in the church, is there little wonder that Paul is calling for unity? Everyone was out fishing for souls. But there were several nets used, so to speak. was in that church in Corinth was not very clear. And so Paul writes to them and tries to tell them not to fall into the trap that the church of our day falls into all too often in trying to follow specific preachers or to catch people for specific congregations instead of the wider church as a whole. And I think that what Paul tries to tell the people in Corinth and us today is beautifully illustrated by the calling of the first disciples in our gospel reading. We are shown there what the focus has been, is, and always has to be for the church to have any impact on society. And by church, I'm not talking about individual congregations, because they come and go. By church, I mean the small C Catholic, the church universal. The communities which proclaim the good news of the saving grace of Jesus the Christ, regardless of denominations or place. I've always marveled at the way that Simon and Andrew, James and John responded to Jesus' call to follow him. Their focus was on Christ in such a way that they left everything behind, their trade, their families, everything, to follow Jesus. And his call made sure that they would not be doing any ordinary fishing, that's for sure. Instead of pulling things into the boat for themselves, they would do the opposite. They would go out and give to others, share the good news of the gospel, share the good news of salvation among the people. This call from Jesus into his ministry was not only extended to the first disciples, though. It is a call that goes out to this very day. It is a call that goes out to you and me because Christ called us on a personal basis at the font through the water and word in our baptism while we are marked by the cross of Christ forever. We are the ones who are called in this time and day to go out into society and cast out the debts for Christ. But sadly, we often seem to answer this call simply by asking, what's in it for me? Before we do anything else. Or we decide that to follow Christ is the thing to do because it will protect us from the pains and heartaches of life. But as we all know way too well, following Christ does not give us immunity from the pains of life. Interesting note is that instead of asking what's in it for me, we find that in today's gospel reading, Jesus doesn't even say that to follow him will lead to salvation. Instead, he says that if you follow him, there is work to be done. Work as in fishing for people, building community, so that we become, as the Apostle Paul said, one body with many parts, working for the common good. It is not an easy task that we are asked to do as disciples. To follow Christ means at times to be inviting and caring in a very uninviting and uncaring world. But we have a prophetic call to follow Jesus in reaching out to those in need in our society. And we all know that the need is out there, and it is growing as the gap between the rich and poor is growing wider. Our call as followers of Christ is then to respond to the world around us with love, care, and compassion. That's what's in it for us. Turning back to 1 Corinthians, Paul said in chapter 13, what good is it if we speak or act with good intentions, but without love? And the love that Paul is talking about here is the love that Christ displayed, the servant who gave of himself to others, the servant whose life changed the world forever. When our focus as a Christian is on the gospel and all that it stands for, we then find that our labor of love will bring us more love. It will also help us overcome things. In Christ, we are assured of a love that will never end. We know this love to be greater than anything else that we have ever experienced. We know that God's love for us through Christ is a love that showers grace and forgiveness on us again and again and again, in spite of ourselves. This unselfish giving of God through our Savior Jesus the Christ, is then the example for us in our call to serve the community of faith that we belong to and in the community around us that we live in. So all of this is done to say that we need to join Peter, Andrew, James, and John in stepping out in faith. We need to take our cue from the call of the first disciples and say yes, yes to Jesus' call and be fishers of people for the gospel. Working together in unity with our brothers and sisters in our congregation and among other Christian denominations. We need to do this because we are standing at the proverbial nature with Jesus looking into our eyes and calling us by name. Knowing that he is the one to guide us in our work, we can then with confidence say yes to this call to follow him. And for that invitation and the faith to respond in the affirmative, all we can then do is to say it ever so humble, thanks be to God. Amen.
Born of the Virgin Mary, suffered
Let us boldly pray for the church, the world, and all in need.
Inspire us all in service to you. We pray today for the vote. Pray for the vote today regarding the cooperative work agreement between our congregation and St. James, and the calling of Pastor Grant as our new pastor. Inspire your people to hear your voice so that all may know your love. Lord, in your mercy. Make your church one in purpose, proclaiming the message of the cross. Help us to work together across differences. Energize ecumenical partnerships, including the World Council of Churches and Lutheran World Federation. Lord, in your mercy. We rejoice at the bounty of your creation. Fill the land and sea with your abundance. Bless harvests in the southern hemisphere and fallow fields in the northern hemisphere. Equip farmers to sustainably till and keep the earth. Lord, in your mercy. In Christ, your reign comes near and calls up all to repentance. Break the rod of the oppressor in every nation. Dispel the shadow of death in places of war and persecution, especially in Ukraine. Grant us leaders who lift the yokes that burden those in need. Lord, in your mercy. Be a stronghold for those in trouble and a rock for all who are afraid. Rouse communities to care for neighbors who need shelter, are facing maltreatment, or are isolated and lonely. We pray especially for Aloha, Caroline, Amy, Mary, Warren, Sarah, Linda, Matthew, Bev, Margie, Marlene, Bruce, Paul, Camille, Trish, John, Doris, Amy, Lila, Bill, Fern, Kathy, Linda, Dick, Janice, Harry, Lucille, Carol, Joyce, Jeff, and Kathy. Lord, in your mercy. Sustain the ministries of this congregation and all churches in our community. Nurture each congregation's unique witness to your presence. Foster mutual respect. Inspire our cooperation in loving our neighbors. Bless all those who attend the support groups that meet in our space. Lord, in your mercy. Let your Holy Spirit guide the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, our National Bishop Elizabeth, our Southeast Michigan Synod, and our Bishop Donald. Hear our prayers for all congregations in our conference, thinking today especially of St. Mark Lutheran Church in Roseville and their pastor, Jordan Oberle. Lord, in your mercy. We praise you for the faithful who have gone ahead of us, both famous and unknown. Help us to leave our nets and follow you, and bring us with them to the fullness of your promise of eternal life. Lord, in your mercy.
Trusting in the presence of God by the power of the Holy Spirit, we commend all of them, we pray, dwelling in the light and hope of Christ our Savior. Amen. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Share that peace with us all. You may be seated as we receive our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
blessings, and guide us on our journey. Lead us to your table, nourish us with this heavenly food, and prepare us to carry your love to a hungry world. In the name of Christ our light. Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. By the leaping of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join the remaining prayer. Sent from heaven to a virgin's womb, hitherto called a manger and a lot, that was shown forth as your Son, born of the Holy Spirit and of the Virgin Mary. He, our Lord Jesus, fulfilled all your will and won for you a holy people. He stretched out his hands in suffering in order to free from suffering those who trust you. He is the one who handed over to a death he freely accepted in order to destroy death, to break the bonds of the evil one, to crush hell underfoot, to give light to the righteous, to establish his covenant, and to show forth the resurrection. Taking bread and giving thanks to you, said, take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. In the same way he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Remembering then his death and resurrection, we take this bread and cup, giving you thanks that you have made us worthy to stand before you and to serve you as your priestly people. Send your spirit upon these gifts of your church. Gather into one all who share this bread and wine. Fill us with your Holy Spirit to establish our faith in truth, that we may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ, through whom all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. As Jesus taught us, we pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come to the banquet, for all is now ready, and all are welcome. Christ given for you. Take the bread. The blood of Christ shed for you. Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in this place.
Son.